A'udhu billahi minash shaitani lain rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah, who is the most kind, the most beneficent, and the most merciful. Respected resident alim, Maulana Syed Muhammad Rizvi. Respected scholars, president of the ISIJ of Toronto, my elders, brothers and sisters in faith, salamun alaikum. As I was introduced, my name is Kazim Kanani, and it is absolutely an honor and a privilege for me to be before you this evening once again to present the Last Rites, Funerals and Process Seminar. Of course, as we all know it, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have come, and to Him that we shall ultimately return. And it has been told to all of us that we shall all taste death, so we should indeed start to prepare as early as we can. This evening, I want to give a brief introduction, and I want to touch on a few items. I want to give you an introduction to Jaffari Funeral Services, a subcommittee of the ISIJ of Toronto. I want to talk about some of the services that we offer, as well as review the processes and the procedures that we have. Talk about the cemetery options that are available to all members, as well as some of the rules surrounding the cemeteries. Give an overview of the funeral services process. Talk about member benefits, as well as discuss non-member funerals as well. I want to touch briefly on the burial assistance plan that we have, make reference to a couple of resources, and then just share a couple of announcements before we get to the Q&A portion of the evening. So our facilities, I must state that we do have state-of-the-art ghusl kafan facilities right here at JCC, which was kindly donated by Al-Hajj Abid Bhai Himani. It is a one-of-a-kind facility that we have here. It is a facility that that no other Jamaat actually has. So if you ever have the opportunity of touring the building and taking a look, please come and join us. You're more than welcome to take a look at the facilities that we have. All of the facilities that we have here at the ISIJ of Toronto are licensed by the Bereavement Authority of Ontario, also known as the BAO. And in addition to that, our funeral service providers are also individually licensed by the BAO as well. And all of our services, alhamdulillah, are provided in-house, meaning we do not use any third-party service providers at all. Our team is made up of dedicated and committed volunteers, both on the ladies and the gent side, who provide their time fi sabilillah. There are absolutely no paid staff members involved while we render our services. Our team consists of our Honorable Mukhi, Mehboob Bhai Siuji, who is not only the JFS Board of Directors liaison, but also the Mukhi of our Jamaat, and so he is also the individual that gets that very first phone call. And on the ladies' side, it is headed up by our chairladies, Sister Zara Bhai Dilawar. Of course, the leadership team consists of Mubarak Bhai Mamdani, who is our chair, Muhammad Taqi Bhai Sabur, vice chair, and myself as secretary. And on the lady side, Sister Sajida Bhai Habib, who is on the ladies committee and is the ghusl kafan lead. And she is assisted by Sister Nusrat Bhai Davdani on the ladies committee. Of course, we are only the leadership team. We are supported by a team of over 40 dedicated male and over 40 dedicated female volunteers that represent not just the members of the JCC, but also represent members of MIC as well. Some of the services that we provide in a nutshell, as I had mentioned, everything is done start to finish in-house. So starting with the assembling or the building of the caskets, many of you who attend Fajr prayers on the weekends would see us after the prayers in the hallways actually assembling caskets. We look after the transportation for the deceased as well from the place of death right up until we get the deceased to the cemetery. All ghusl and kafan services are provided in-house. Unlike other centers around the world, we actually obtain all of the necessary permits and documentation that is required in order to perform the funeral in itself. We arrange all of the funeral services as well as the burial services. And as a committee, we also provide education and training not only to students of the Asadiq School, but also the madaris that we have here in Toronto. But we also provide that same education, training, and guidance to other jamaats across North America as well. So let's move on to talking about the process and the overall procedures. So of course, in the event of a death, the next of kin should be calling the ISIJ Mukhi either at the 1-855 number, or if you have Mukhi's direct cell number, you can reach him on his cell directly. He is available for this 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Please don't call this number if you have complaints about anything else. Reserve it only if you have it for mayats. But first phone call always goes to the ISIJ Mukhi. When you are calling the Mukhi, you should have a few pieces of information readily available. First and foremost, the full legal name of the deceased with the correct spelling. The second item is the next of kin's contact information, as well as their relationship and confirmation that you as the next of kin have decision-making authority on behalf of the deceased. You need to inform the Mukhi of where the deceased has passed away, whether it's at home, whether it's at a nursing home, a healthcare facility, or if the body has been transferred to the coroner's office, for example. And last but not least, you need to inform the Mukhi if the death has been certified, either by doctor, nurse, or coroner. The ISIJ Mukhi not only takes this information and gets it ready to pass to JFS, but he will also in the background be verifying membership status as well. And if your membership status has any anomalies in it, he will return a phone call back to you and touch base with you as the next of kin to advise you of the next steps. If everything is in order, he will then advise the JFS chair or the chair's designate. Of course, when someone passes away, there's a few steps that need to be taken to care for the deceased as well. Starting with the removal of all personal belongings off of the deceased. This being rings, earrings, chains, bracelets, etc. They should all be removed as gently as possible, of course. Of course, if the deceased is wearing any dentures, those should be removed if and only if they are removable or easily removed. You should also request any healthcare professional, should the deceased pass away at a nursing care facility or at a hospital, to remove any foreign objects such as tubes, monitors, IVs, etc. Of course, if any of these are left on the deceased, we will do our best during ghusl and kafan to remove them. If it is possible, and if the space is available, gently turn the mayat so that way the deceased's feet are facing the direction of the qibla. Ensure hands and legs are straightened as best as possible. Ensure that the eyes and the mouth are closed. Oftentimes, to close the mouth, you may need to take a towel or a bed sheet and wrap it around the head of the deceased. And cover the mayat with preferably a white cloth and ensure that the room is a well-lit room where the mayat is residing. Of course, additional information that you need to keep on hand is the type of death. Did the deceased die of natural causes? Was it a transmittable disease of sorts or a virus? Or was it as a result of an accident? And this is important for us to know so that way we can prepare the ghusl kafan teams accordingly. If the second item that you should also keep on hand is the deceased's kafan or shroud, and if so, you should know where it is and be able to bring it here to JCC in time for the ghusl and kafan. You should also arrange amongst the family if anybody is going to assist with the ghusl and kafan. If so, who are they? And we allow for a maximum of 3 family members to assist with the ghusl, and there'll be 2 volunteers at all times. Of course, if the person passes away late into the night or late afternoon where we can't actually arrange for burial services, family members are always welcome to stay overnight here at JCC with the mayat to a maximum of 3 individuals at any time. And so we ask that you know who those 3 are going to be. Of course, we always recommend, if it is overnight, that you try to arrange it in shifts with the family, just so the family has some time to get some downtime, get some rest, because the day of the funeral is a long day, oftentimes starting at 9, 10 in the morning and ending around 5, 6 in the evening. So it's highly recommended that families try to plan staying overnight in shifts. And of course, if you are going to be proceeding with the siako, one of the questions that you will be asked is approximately how many people do you anticipate, so that way we can make the necessary arrangements for catering. So of course, if you look at the entire process in a timeline from that initial phone call right to the burial, this timeline can be as long, or I should say as short as 5 hours, or it could be as long as a day or 2 days, depending on circumstances and situations. The reasons why it could be a couple of days, it could be for varying reasons. We could be waiting for immediate family members to arrive from overseas. There may be a statutory holiday in the middle where we are unable to obtain burial permits and the required documentation. In some cases, if it becomes a coroner's case, whether you know a doctor or if there was any foul play suspected, or if it was a younger individual or a medical professional who passes away, generally speaking, it becomes a coroner case. And as I said, it's important that you share this information with us, because one of the things that we are able to do is petition the coroner's office. We have relationships that we have built over the years to see if they can expedite the release of the body. So when you look at that timeline, anywhere between 5 hours up to as long as a couple of days. One of the things that the next of kin will be asked to complete here when they arrive at JCC is something that's referred to as a Form 15. This is a standard statement of death form issued by the province of Ontario. It covers information about the deceased as well as the deceased's parents. And then the rest of the information is something that we complete, but we assist you through this process. So you should have the name of the deceased, their date of birth, place of birth, city and province, as well as their age at the time of death, name of the physician or the coroner who pronounces the death, marital relationship status, occupation or profession, their usual place of address, and as well as the deceased's parents' information, as well, including their first and last name and place of birth as well. And the place of birth information is really used more so for statistics purposes by the province, not so much so for any other purpose other than that. Of course, the next of kin will be offered multiple cemetery options as to where they would like to lay their loved one to rest. And we are blessed to have five cemeteries that we offer, the first being York Cemetery at 101 Sanlac Road in Toronto, where we have double-level graves, i.e. One deceased can be buried on top of the other. We also have Meadowvale Cemetery at 7732 Mavis Road in Brampton, again, a cemetery where we offer two-level or double-level graves. Forest Lawn Cemetery in London, Ontario, where we have single-level graves. Wadi Salam Cemetery in Markham, where we have single-level graves. And Chapel Hill Memorial Gardens in Stony Creek, where we have single-level graves. The next of kin is the person who is responsible for determining or selecting the cemetery of choice. While we have five cemeteries at our disposal and available to us, I must state and inform everyone and be very clear that the ISIJ of Toronto does not own nor operate any of these cemeteries. We only hold interment rights at the five cemeteries. As well, ISIJ members, once their loved ones are buried, do not own the rights to the grave. Those rights are still held by the Jamaat itself. Maintenance of each of the five cemeteries is the responsibility of the cemetery operators. However, should you have any maintenance-related concerns, there's an email address on the screen. It's funeralsec@jaffari.org. Please submit any of your concerns there, and we will do our absolute best to address your concerns with the cemetery operators as we meet with them all on a regular basis. The ISIJ of Toronto, being the interment right holders, are bound by the bylaws, terms and conditions of each of the respective cemeteries. Their bylaws, terms and conditions do vary as well. Of course, we are able to share this information with you. We are happy to answer any questions that you may have when you're making that selection. But it is better to know and understand what each of the cemeteries offer, as well as what the rules and regulations are well in advance of making any of those selections. If you opt to bury your loved one at Wadi Salam Cemetery in Markham, there is an additional out-of-pocket expense for the headstone marker, as well as the interlocking or the grass. The cost currently is $1,900, and that is payable to the Jamaat office upon completion of the burial services. Again, that $1,900 cost only applies to Wadi al-Salam Cemetery, also known as Abu Ali, and it covers the cost of the headstone, as well as the grass work that they have to do, as well as going into maintenance as well. Cemeteries that have the extra deep graves, or the double graves, are only available on a first-come, first-served basis. There are no reservations, meaning if your loved one is buried, say at York Cemetery or at Meadowvale Cemetery, the family will not have the option of reserving the top grave for their loved one. The Jamaat reserves the right to bury anybody on top. Of course, one of the things that we have set in the Jamaat policies is that we will endeavor to use all of the lower level graves first and then commence burying individuals on top. Therefore, if a loved one does pass away before we have utilized all of the lower level, we will give the family the option of burying their loved one on top of an existing loved one that has already been buried, okay? Just going through some protocols that we have for our funeral service, we have developed a standard funeral program for all of our members, regardless of caste, creed, wealth, or status. The funeral program consists of the recitation of the Holy Quran, which includes Surah Yasin, Surah Mulk, and Surah Rahman. We allow for a maximum of 2 speeches by family members, no more than 5 minutes. And a few words will also be said on behalf of the ISIJ by members of Jaffari Funeral Services. We are allow for the viewing of the marhum or marhuma subject to the family's permission. Salatul Mayat is offered here at JCC or at any of our other centers. And then we perform the burial, and at the burial we have the recitation of the Kalme Shahada, as well as the recitation of the Talqeen, and of course the burial in itself. And then there's the Siyako, which is the meal after the burial. If time permits, we will accommodate any additional recitations. However, we aim and endeavor to go through the standard program first. We work with the next of kin to determine who the reciters are, and we prefer that the reciters of the surahs be members of the family. Of course, if family members are not comfortable or are not in the mindset to do so, we will definitely make the necessary arrangements. And we ask that everyone please respect the standard protocols that we have put in place and implemented. When it comes to the siyako itself, the burial, the meal after the burial, in accordance with the burial assistance plan, the next of kin is given 3 options for siyako. Option number 1 is to serve siyako where at the center, where the funeral services take place, whether it is here at JCC, at MIC, or RIC, and you will be and what's included in the burial assistance plan is catering for up to 100 people. The second option that is made available to the family is that the food would be delivered to the family for a period of 3 days to a maximum of 30 people per day. And the third option is to have the cost of the siyako donated to a registered charitable organization which has been approved by the board of directors in memory of the deceased. So these are the 3 options that are available for the siyako. As a member of the ISIJ, there are benefits to being members. And some of these benefits include that as a member, you are entitled to the full and complete funeral services arranged by making that one phone call. You don't have to run around. You don't have to make any other phone calls. You don't have to chase death certificates or burial permits. That one phone call looks after all of the funeral services for your loved one. Transportation of the deceased from anywhere within the province of Ontario. So if your loved one passes away in any hospital in Ontario, any nursing home, any residence, family members may be up at a cottage, for example, transportation is included and covered. However, if your loved one passes away outside of the borders of the province of Ontario, the family members are responsible for arranging the transportation of the deceased here to the JCC, to the center. We are not able to pick up a deceased at the border, you know, at one of the en routes or at, you know, at another funeral home. We can only pick up mayats within the province of Ontario in itself. You are also entitled as a member, you're entitled to the cost of a hall rental, a designated space within any of our facilities whether it's here at Jaffari Community Center, at Masumin Islamic Center, Rizvi Community Center, or any of our affiliate centers as well, to host a majlis within the first 3 days of after the burial. Of course, the hall rental is subject to availability, and of course, we will make as many concessions and as accommodations as possible should there be Jamaat functions taking place. As ISIJ members and as Sister Alia mentioned previously, JSS does provide professional counseling services which are available. The ISI, as a member, ISIJ will sponsor a majlis on the first Thursday night after the burial. And if you pass away out of the country or the province, the ISIJ will reimburse members, provided an application is made, up to $5,000 or to the lesser of the actual costs. Whichever is the lesser amount, the family will be reimbursed. And I should note that the average funeral cost for a member is approximately $10,000, okay? And only a portion of the membership dues actually goes towards the burial assistance plan. And in some cases, that is actually as low as only $30 per year per family. So being a member, it allows and avails a huge significant savings cost benefit to the members as well. Oftentimes, we are asked about non-members, and for non-members, we have policies and procedures which are in place. We will provide non-members with funeral services, provided they meet any one of the following criteria. The first is that in the event that the deceased is visiting from out of province or country and is a member in good standing with the Jamaat where they primarily reside. The second criteria is that in the event that the deceased is visiting and is closely related to a member of the ISIJ and closely related in our policies, has been defined as mother, father, mother-in-law, father-in-law, brother, sister, brother-in-law, sister-in-law. So it's not, I know we're all related, it doesn't just automatically mean everybody is covered under that. The third instance is when the ISIJ of Toronto is notified of a deceased by authorities, such as the police, a coroner's office, or the city, when they're unable to track down family members or next of kin, we are oftentimes asked. And then if we are asked by another Shia organization who is seeking assistance, we will definitely be providing it to other Shia centers. And then finally, at the discretion of the president or the president's designate. We do not provide non-member funerals otherwise. For non-member funerals, they are referred, the next of kin will be referred to other Shia Muslim funeral providers. And in the event the ISIJ performs any non-member funeral, the next of kin will bear all financial costs and responsibilities at market rates. The costs of non-member funerals are determined by the ISIJ Board of Directors and the Secretariat Office. This policy has been put in place not only so we can maintain our license requirements with the BAO, but also to ensure that we are not overburdening our volunteers, our facilities, with funeral services for non-members. Of course, and I'm going to try to do this very quickly, the burial assistance plan is directly linked to each individual's membership. It cannot be purchased separately outside of membership, and new members are all subjected to a vesting period over the course of 11 years before your full funeral rites are covered under the BAP. So if I take that $10,000 burial cost example, or that approximate number of $10,000, if you've only been a member for 6 years, for example, you will still be, or your family will still be responsible for paying $5,000. It's only when you get into year 11 that your full funeral costs are covered. Resources, of course, we are all available as JFS to provide any resources and assistance. Maulana Rizvi has published a very short, easy-to-read book, which is available through the Tabligh bookstore. It's called Death Before, During, and After. And finally, just a couple of announcements before I turn it over to Maulana Sahib. First and foremost, York Cemetery, which is the one at 101 Sanlac Road, any upright temporary markers or upright monuments that have been installed by families or any objects should be removed by June the 30th of this year. Anything that is left remaining will be disposed of by the cemetery. You'll notice in the picture, and I know it's a bit small, you see the black temporary signs that have been placed, and some have gone ahead and installed permanent versions of those. Those will all be removed as of June the 30th. At Al Hussein Foundation Cemetery, also known as Wadi Salam, members are notified that the second row of graves on the southeast side will be leveled in preparation for the placement of grass and markers, as well as seasonal maintenance work will be commencing this month. We ask that you please refrain from erecting monuments and barriers of any sort around each of the graves, and that you refrain from planting any flowers, shrubs, trees, or bushes on the southeast grassed area, as we are trying to maintain a clean look, and there is a plan that will be implemented in the future for the planting of trees, shrubs, etc. So we ask that you please respect the rules of these two cemeteries and adhere to them as best as you can. If you have any questions, please reach out to us. We are happy to answer any questions that you may have. And with that, and before we get to question and answer, I'm going to turn it over to Maulana Sahib to enlighten us. But before I do, the one request I have of our Jamaat is we are, mashallah, a very large Jamaat. Last year, Maulana Sahib spoke about the benefits and the importance of attending funerals. While we understand that funerals happen at the snap of a finger and not everyone is always available, but today I implore you all as members of the Jamaat to try to come out to as many of the funerals as you can, not only to see what the process and procedures and the formalities look like, but more so to come and support your fellow member and their grieving family during this difficult time of need. It's unfortunate that the Funeral Services Subcommittee has had to host funerals and perform burials with only 4 to 8 members, or 4 to 8 people, I should say, at the funeral, when we have, mashallah, such a large and vibrant community. I implore you all to please do take the time and the opportunity, even if you don't know the name of the person who's passed away, just by coming out and attending, it shows a lot of support to the families as well. With that, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد والأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقية لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم كل نفس زائقة الموت. By looking at the interest of time, I think even we have question answers after that.
We will try.
How many questions have come in?
I have 3 questions.
3 questions. Okay, not bad. Okay. So I'll make my remarks very brief. I think the whole idea of this meeting was to inform the community about the role of the funeral board and, you know, how things operate. It's important for people to realize this. As far as the religious perspective is concerned, let me just, as a preamble to any questions which will come, begin by talking about the importance of this phenomenon of death. This is a very lucky phenomenon or concept in the world of humanity. There are people who deny the existence of God. There are people who reject the Quran as the revelation of God. There are people who don't believe in the Prophet as the messenger of God. There are many who actually say, when you talk about resurrection and day of judgment and life in hereafter, this is all myth. But there is not anyone on the face of the earth who is a sane and sensible person who would deny the reality of death. And that is why in Islamic terminology, the word maut is sometimes also described by the word al-yaqeen, You know, every Thursday night we recite Ziyarat Warisa, and we have a statement there where we say that we testify of Hussein that you obeyed Allah and Rasul hatta atakal yaqeen, that you obeyed the Allah and the Rasul until you became satisfied. Well, Hussein obeyed Allah all the time. There the word yaqeen means hatta al-maut. And so this is a reality. Nobody can run away. There is no exception to this issue. As Mirani says, you know, jo zinda ho wo maut ki takleef sahega, jab Ahmad Mursal na rahe, kaun rahega? So nobody is going to live forever. And therefore, you know, this whole concept of preparing for death is an important issue. We should be actually thinking about it and preparing ourselves for this. Not to leave it for the last moment and not to leave it to the family to make the important decisions. Especially when it comes to the arrangement for the funeral and the expenses related to that. You know, this is actually, you can dedicate that and it would come out from your estate before it is divided. The wajib expenses would come out from there. And this is where you will realize that when we talk about the facility that you have under ISIJ, especially about the funeral, program. What is it called? BAP?
BAP.
Okay. Marne ke baap baap hi hoga na, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So it's a very unique facility, and I think ISIJ is the pioneer in establishing that. And it's important to know the rights that you have as a member in that way, and it was good to see and hear about it more clearly. And so what I would say is that, you know, this issue of non-members facilities and funeral came up. I would just like to say that we have to make the arrangement ourselves. The community is there, alhamdulillah. But if we get a case where a Muslim has died and the community is not taking care of that funeral rites, then it becomes a collective responsibility of the community. It becomes wajib kifai. So always keep that in mind that yes, you know, we plan everything according to our procedures, but that wajib kifai element is there when it comes to a Muslim who has no one to take care of himself or herself as far as the funeral process is concerned. We just have about 14 minutes before namaz time, so I think we just go to the question answers.
Thank you, Maulana Sahib. The first question that I have for you, Maulana Sahib, that I've received actually is with respect to DNRs or do not resuscitates. What are the guidelines, if any, that should be implemented and put in place or followed by a family for a loved one?
To make it very brief, you know, if the illness of the individual is such that there is still cure available for that from the medical point of view, then to seek that cure is wajib. So you cannot say, you know, do not resist it. That is only applicable if it is a terminal case, nothing else can be done. Only then that would be applicable. So the family or the individual have to be informed about this issue. They should be knowledgeable about it. We get this question many, many times, and we are available to, you know, advise and help people in making that decision case by case. And so it's not a black and white issue that yes or no. It depends on the situation.
Thank you. Maulana Sahib, two questions with respect to Salatul Mayyat. The first is, why don't we have to perform wudu for Salatul Mayyat? And the second question is, can Salatul Mayyat be performed from home or online, or does the person have to be physically be at the mosque?
Can we have some silence on the sister's side, please? You can have your Fatiha and chai, but please be quiet. As far as this question of namaz-e-janazah is concerned, why there is no need for taharat? If you look at the format of namaz-e-janazah, it is actually not a salat as such. It is more dua. And because it is not formally a salat, you know, the requirements of taharat is not there. So you don't need to be in the state of taharat. You don't even need to have wudu, let alone ghusl, if it becomes wajib. And if it's done outside the masjid, a person can still participate. So that's as far as namaz-e-janazah is concerned. Can you do it online? No. You can watch it, you can recite dua for the marhum or marhuma, but you cannot do namaz-e-janazah online.
Thank you. I know there's a lot of questions coming in about the BAP as well, and I will try to address them in a couple of minutes. I'm trying to address all of the questions that are addressed for Maulana Sahib as quickly as I can as well. Maulana Sahib, cremation, is it permitted in Islam, and if a member or a deceased puts that in their will, what is the obligation on the next of kin?
Cremation is haram in Islam. If I may put it in a more slighter tone, we don't want to send our family members to the fire, you know, ourselves. We leave it for the Qiyamah, if there is any case of like that. And so it is haram, haram, haram. There is no second opinion or alternative fatwa or dispute on the mujtahideen on this issue. The only proper way of disposing the body of a human being has been described in the Quran in the example of Habil. When his brother killed him, that's where you see the whole process where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the example of the crow to teach the human beings, you know, how to dispose the body of a human being. And so there's no room for cremation. If anyone, a Muslim, does that, they should be advised not to put that in their will. And if it's done by someone, then the next of kin, if they have the authority to change that, they should do it, even if it's against the wishes of the deceased. And if they don't have the authority, they are not allowed to be part of it. You cannot be part of the act which is considered to be haram.
Maulana Sahib, questions with respect to placing water on the grave. What is the significance of placing water on the grave? And is there any benefit to the deceased when water is placed after the first 40 days?
There is a recommendation after the burial to put water on the grave the way it is done. Of course, you know, this custom that we have, that the almost entire family comes and puts the water, that's not the requirement. The main thing is that, you know, what the grave should be watered after the burial takes place. And there is no recommendation after that, although there is no prohibition either. But what is the reason for it? One of the ahadith that we have is that when you put water on the grave, as long as the grave has that wetness of the water, that becomes an excuse for preventing azab al-qabr from that mayyit. And so that's just one of the, what I would call, excuses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks for, you know, expanding his mercy.
Thank you. And the last question for you, Maulana Sahib, is with respect to Qums, starting with Qums, does a next of kin have to pay Qums for their deceased parents or grandparents, had their deceased parents or grandparents not paid it, one? And number two, if you only have a daughter and no son, who takes responsibility or carriage of the qaza prayers for the marhum?
As far as the Qums issue is concerned, that would be the financial liability on the estate. If it's known that the person was supposed to pay Qums but he or she didn't, then that has to be taken out before the estate is divided. As far as the qaza, you know, prayers is concerned, the wujub is on the surviving oldest son, not on the daughter. But there is no prohibition. If the daughter or a younger, you know, children want to do that on their own, you know, choice, there is nothing which prevents them from doing it. But the obligation falls on the eldest son only. And that is only in case of the qaza prayers which were missed out because of an excuse. So it's not that, you know, if a person was totally careless, negligent about namaz for his whole life, then becoming the eldest son becomes a curse. You know, and that's not the obligation. The obligation is only when you come to realize, maybe during some journey or traveling or the last days of life, you know, he was not in a situation of doing it. Those are the times, those are the situations where it is wajib for the eldest son to fulfill the prayers. Yeah.
Thank you, Maulana Sahib. In 1 minute or less, I will try to answer some questions with respect to the BAP. Somebody has asked if a child under the age of 11 passes away, would the family be on the hook for the cost of the burial? If the parents are members, the answer is no. Your children under the age of 18 are fully covered under the burial assistance plan, provided that the parents are members. There was a question about transporting the body from anywhere in the province of Ontario, and someone had used an example online of using Fort Severn, which is a fly-in community. If a member of the ISIJ passes away, for example, in Fort Severn, yes, we would make the arrangements and look after transporting that mayat here to JCC for burial services. If someone passes away in Winnipeg and they're a member in good standing, the family will be responsible for arranging the transportation to Ontario, specifically directly to the center. Thereafter, we would look after all costs through the burial assistance plan. If a family member or a next of kin opts to have their loved one buried at another cemetery, one that is not of the five that I had listed, we will still perform burial services at that cemetery. The ISIJ of Toronto will look after the opening and closing costs up to a maximum amount, which is stated in the policies, and the family will be responsible for all other costs associated. With that, I am going to turn it back over to Maulana Sahib for a short masayib before we proceed for Salat. Wassalamu alaikum.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Muhammadin wa ala tahirin. اپنی سپیچ میں ہم نے فیونرل کے بارے میں واجب کفائی کا مسئلہ پیش کیا تھا کہ دین اسلام میں اگر کوئی مسلمان مر جاتا ہے اور اس کو کوئی وارث نہ ہو تو پوری کمیونٹی ذمہ دار بن جاتی ہے اگر اس کو غسل کفن اور نماز جنازہ اور دفن کے مراسم نہیں پورے کیے گئے تو پوری کمیونٹی اس ایریا میں جو ہے وہ ذمہ دار ہوگی قیامت کے دن اللہ کے نظر میں. تاریخ اسلام میں سب سے بڑا المیہ یہی ہے کہ وہ رسول جو یہ حکم لے کے آئے تھے کہ کسی بھی مسلم میت, شیعہ شرط نہیں ہے, مسلم میت کی بات ہو رہی ہے, اس کو غسل کفن نماز اور دفن بغیر چھوڑنا یہ جو ہے گناہ میں سے ہے, اور کمیونٹی جو ہے واجب کفائی کے عنوان سے کلیکٹیولی رسپانسبل ہوگی اللہ کی نظر میں. لیکن ہم لوگ دیکھتے ہیں کہ کربلا میں کیا ہوا تھا. وہ رسول جو یہ حکم لے کے آئے تھے ان کے نواسے کے ساتھ کیا کیا مسلمانوں ہی نے, وہاں پرسے دینے کی بات نہیں ہے, وہاں دفن کرنے کی بات نہیں ہے, لیکن جو منظر ہم دیکھتے ہیں یزیدی لشکر سے یہی کہا جاتا ہے نا کہ تمہارا پولیٹیکل اور سیاسی اختلاف تھا, حسین سے جنگ ہوئی, آپ نے حسین کو قتل کر دیا ہے. قتل کرنے کے بعد چھوڑ دے ان کو, لیکن نہیں, عمر بن سعد جو ہے اعلان کرتا ہے کہ ابن زیاد کا خاص آرڈر ہے کہ حسین کے قتل کے بعد ان کے لاش کو پامال کیا جائے. عمر بن سعد نے ولنٹیئرز مانگے ہیں, اور افسوس کی بات یہ ہے کہ رسول کے وفات کے 50 سال زیادہ عرصہ نہیں تھا, ہزاروں کی تعداد تھی مسلمانوں کی, وہاں 10 ملعون آگے بڑھتے ہیں اپنے گھوڑوں کے ساتھ کہ ہم لوگ اس کام کو پورا کرنے کے لیے تیار ہیں, اور یہ جب گھوڑے تیار ہوئے اور مشرق سے مغرب کی طرف گئے اور مغرب سے مشرق کی طرف آئے, چھٹے امام کی روایت ہے کہ میرے جد حسین کے سینے کی ہڈیاں پشت کے ہڈیوں سے جا کے مل جاتی ہیں. جناب زینب نے جو منظر دیکھا ہے, آسمان کی طرف نظر کر کے کہتی ہے, نانا آسمان کے ملائک آپ پر صلوات پڑھتے ہیں, زمین پر آ کے دیکھیں کہ آپ کے نواسے کی لاش کی کس طرح سے بے حرمتی کی جا رہی. علی لعنۃ اللہ علی القوم الظالمین سیعلم الذین ظلموا ای منقلب ینقلبون. الفاتحہ. بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم, الحمد للہ رب العالمین, الرحمن الرحیم, مالک یوم الدین, اياک نعبد و اياک نستعین.